Good afternoon, and welcome to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, psychologist, professor, author, blogger, podcaster, and your host. Today, our topic is same-sex parents. Happy, slightly belated Father's Day, everybody. If you're a father or have a father you're close to, I hope you were able to celebrate yesterday. Although we know that not all fathers are good ones, dads play an important role in many of our lives. I know my father is listening right now, as he does every week, and I want to wish him a very happy Father's Day. Of course, it's also LGBTQ Pride Month. Given that we're still in the midst of COVID, the festivities aren't quite what they've been in previous years, but it's nonetheless an important time to stop and celebrate the contributions of queer individuals, as well as to renew the fight for LGBTQ rights. So, given the convergence of Father's Day and Pride Month, I thought we could talk today about gay fathers and LGBT parents in general. As I always do when I'm considering something for the show, I went searching for a book, one whose author I could invite to be a guest. I was surprised, however, to find an incredible lack of writing on this topic. And as a gay man myself, although I don't have any children, I found this a little disturbing. As we'll hear today, in addition to the challenges faced by all parents, and I think we can admit that parenting is hard no matter who you are, gay parents face significant additional challenges, whether we're talking about the complications of adoption or surrogacy or many other issues. How do you talk to your children about the fact that they have two dads or two moms? How do you deal with schools that aren't accepting or acknowledging of same-sex parents? And whose last name does the child take? These are just some of the issues that, in addition to the many joys of being a parent, we'll be discussing today. Indeed, my guest today is the author of one of the few and best books on the topic of gay fathers, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads. Eric Rosswood is an award-winning writer and commentator on LGBTQ issues, including civil rights, parenting, marriage, and politics. He has led LGBTQ parenting panels for organizations such as Family Equality Council and the Modern Family Alliance. On top of these accomplishments, he is also the co-author of three additional books, Journey to Same-Sex Parenthood, We Make It Better, the LGBTQ Community and Their Positive Contributions to Society, and My Uncle's Wedding, a book about marriage equality for children. Eric Rosswood, welcome to About Health.
Thank you for having me, David. I'm happy to be here.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you here. And Eric, before we start talking about LGBTQ parents, which we will in a minute, I wanted to acknowledge that we also celebrated Juneteenth this past weekend, a holiday celebrating the end of African-American slavery. In fact, as I'm sure listeners already know, it was just signed into law as an official federal holiday by President Biden and Vice President Harris. So I also wanted to start by just saying how exciting it is to acknowledge Juneteenth, in addition to saying to you and everyone, happy Father's Day and happy Pride. So welcome.
Thank you. Happy Pride to you, too. And I'm very excited that Juneteenth was signed into law as well with the education for it, because I was not taught about it in high school or any school. And I think it's definitely something that we need to teach all kids. So that's great to hear.
Absolutely. Well, I'm thrilled to have you here today. And let me start our conversation by just giving you a compliment and saying, I really enjoyed your book, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads. I thought it struck a great balance between being informative on the one hand and supportive and empathic towards how hard parenthood can be on the other hand. So let me start by just asking, why did you write this book?
I wrote this book because, it was a continuation from my first book, which was Journey to Same-Sex Parenthood. And the reason I wrote that one is because when my husband and I decided we wanted to start a family, we didn't know how to go about it. We didn't know if we wanted to pursue adoption or go the surrogacy route, foster care. There were so many different paths to parenthood, and I wanted to research it. And the only books I could find were from like psychologists or from agencies. So the perspective was one-sided. And I didn't get very much from the perspective of parents who had actually been on the journey. So my first book, I went through and collected a ton of stories from various people who have gone through the different paths and put their stories in a book to help other people kind of weigh the different options to move forward with parenthood and decide which one was best for them. And The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads kind of picks up where that one left off. And it talks about, you know, what are the kind of things you're going to encounter once you are a parent? Like what you said, finding LGBTQ friendly schools and pediatricians, questions you get asked from strangers, all kinds of things that you don't normally typically have as a family with straight parents.
Now, I know your book, at least your latest one, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads, was specifically written for gay fathers, which is, of course, fitting for our Father's Day episode. But as I was reading it, it kept occurring to me that a lot of what you were writing there applies equally well, or at least almost as well, to two moms raising a child as well. Am I right to say that?
It could, yes. There are some things that are going to be very specific to two moms that are not going to apply to two dads and vice versa. For example, breastfeeding or nursing, those are not going to be things that sure. two gay dads are going to need to know about. So my goal with this book was to take general parenting books, all the tips and techniques that you have in those, but take out the things that don't apply, and then also add in specific things that are specifically for our community. But some things are beneficial to anyone in the LGBTQ community, such as, you know, we're talking about finding pediatricians in schools and things like that.
Well, I know, and you mentioned a second ago that you have kids. I think you have two young kids. And I hope I'm not getting too personal by asking, why did you decide to start a family? And let me give you a little context. As a gay man myself, I've thought many times about how the decision to adopt kids or have kids is in some sense so much more intentional and effortful for gay folks than straight couples. And I'm by no means saying that straight people don't make intentional decisions or put real effort into having kids. Of course they do, but there's just so much resistance and so many unique issues having to do with being same-sex parents. And of course, society still has so much resistance to same-sex adoption and surrogacy and parenthood. So what inspired you to undertake all of this, to face all of this as a parent?
It's interesting because as a kid growing up, I mean, I'm a child of the 80s, and I've always wanted to have a family and get married. And I mean, I grew up on Disney films, and you're always seeing at the end, you know, they're getting married and going off and living happily ever after. And then as I was getting older and realizing my identity, I kind of started thinking those things weren't an option for me, that I wouldn't be able to get married, I wouldn't be able to have a family. And you see marriage equality passing not that long ago. And I remember, you know, pushing and fighting to help make that happen as well. I wasn't like the one who helped make it happen, but I was also in the streets with all the activists that were protesting and things like that. And you kind of envision like, okay, this is something that's obtainable. I can get married. And after marriage equality passed as well, it's like, okay, well, we can live happy, healthy lives, and we can continue to expand our family. I've always wanted kids. And I mean, even before marriage equality was legal, it was something I still wanted, just whether or not I thought I could do it.
Yeah. It's a beautiful story. And, I had similar reactions, you know, when suddenly gay marriage was legal, or not so suddenly, but when finally gay marriage was legal, it was such a freeing experience for me, and really opened my sense up that I could have a kind of life, and that perhaps society would acknowledge me for that kind of life that I maybe never thought I could have. So I think that's just a beautiful story, and I imagine a lot of people in the audience can connect with that. Now, you start your book with in a wonderful way, with a list of things that you say that people normally won't tell you about being a gay dad. And some of them, I'm laughing because some of them definitely made me laugh, including you're going to get kicked in the balls a lot.
Oh my God, from all the roughhousing.
But there was one, a little more serious one that stood out to me. And it was that when you're out with your children, you will get looks from other people all the time. And you're right that people frequently ask where the mother is. And you even mention that sometimes gay dads get accused of kidnapping their own children. I have to admit that none of this necessarily surprises me, but it does point to the fact that even in the year 2021, society still has pretty rigid expectations of gender roles and gender norms and norms about what roles parents play. Can you address that for a few minutes?
Sure. There's a lot of different things that happen when there's a single male with a baby. And my personal experience, and I just want to preference this, that I wrote this book. I wanted to get a bunch of experiences from other people and put it together so that when readers are reading this book, they can see a scenario and see how other people handle the situation and maybe try to choose the one that they think best fits for them. So when I talk about these things, I don't pretend like, hey, I'm going to tell you what to do. I'm just giving options. So for me and my experience, I got a lot of looks when I was alone with my son when he was a baby. I was a stay-at-home dad. And when my husband was at work, I was the one, you know, alone with the kid going grocery shopping. And every single time I went shopping, I would get comments from strangers in the grocery line. I've had people tell me that they were followed by someone who thought it was suspicious that a single male was alone with the baby. I've had other people talk to me about how strangers have come up and picked up their children. I've had that experience where someone grabbed my son out of my arms when I was on a plane once.
Wow.
So it's very interesting. I have not had that experience with our daughter. Normally I'm out with both my kids at the same time and I don't get the same thing happening with two kids that I did with one, but it does happen quite a bit.
And how do you suggest that people handle that? I mean, I know you don't have any magic answers here, but how did you handle that? How do other people handle that? I imagine that, you know, a lot of times people who do these things are well-meaning in the sense that they're hoping to protect the children, but at the same time, this is a microaggression, right? I mean, it's a heterosexist or homophobic act. So how do you address that with people?
I think the majority of instances where these things happen, it is with good intentions. Like the most common one is, where's your mother? Is a question that comes out a lot, or where is the child's mother? Mm. And what I think is important is that people who are new parents realize that you don't owe these people answers if you don't want to give the answers. When the child is a little bit older, they're going to be able to understand what's being asked and how their parents are reacting. So if a parent gets defensive in front of the child when a stranger asks, where's your mother, they might start thinking something is wrong. Like, the child might start thinking, you know, what's wrong with this? Why are you acting defensive? Mm-hmm. And they might internalize that. So I think there's a lot of different things to think about. How old is your child? How you're reacting in front of your child, and how you want to present those kinds of conversations. The way you react to it might depend on your mood. Maybe you had your coffee that day, maybe you hadn't, and you're just not in the mood to have those kinds of conversations. Other times, you may want to have them. The person may see you with a child and think, you know, I have a gay relative that may want to adopt or have surrogacy, and maybe that's their way of, you know, trying to find out more information about that. Mm-hmm. We never know where they're coming from. So you can be very short and just not answer it. When I first answered, I remember the first time I said, I'm his mother, which was really weird, but it was like the first thing that popped out of my head. Later on, my answers kind of evolved. So So for us, we have an open adoption, and we are still in contact with our children's birth parents. So in our instance, we say, you know, our child has a mother, and he knows where his mother lives. He knows his mother's name. Both of our kids know both of their birth parents, and, you know, we have ongoing relationships with them. So it's great for us. It works for us. Some families may not have that relationship with their birth parents. It just depends.
And I love what you said about you don't owe that person who's asking whatever question this is, you don't owe them an answer. Right?
Right?
You can give them an answer. That's your right to decide what sort of answer you give them. I think that's a very empowering point that it's important to remember, yeah?
It is, yeah. And, you know, sometimes when it happens a lot, it can be exhausting. Like for me, when we had our first child, every single time I went out of the house, I was asked those questions. Mm. And sometimes it was four or five times on one trip to the grocery store.
Wow.
So it could be overwhelming. And then I've talked to some people who just don't get those questions at all. So I think a lot of it might have to do with geography, where you live, you know, how open people are to having same-sex parents. And, you know, it may just be new to them. And some people may not know how to act, they may not have seen someone who's gay before, and this may be their first experience. So you never know.
Yeah, and really what this gets to, as you're talking about, is knowledge and ignorance of same-sex parents, of gay parents. But it also gets to our expectations about gender roles, as we were talking about a second ago. As you keep talking, I just keep thinking that as gay men and women, we can so easily internalize those same sort of stereotypical traditional gender roles as other people, as members of the straight community, even if we don't intend to. I'd imagine people often model their own roles as parents on what they saw from their parents. And unfortunately, many dads, at least of my generation, and I'm in my 40s, assumed pretty traditional gender roles. My dad is a fantastic person, but when I look at the roles that he and my mom played, they fell pretty clearly along gendered lines. Can you talk about some of the ways that these internalized gender norms can influence same-sex parents and the roles they play with regard to the kids?
Yeah, sure. I think that's a really interesting topic as well, because for me, my dad, he went and he worked, and my mom, she worked as well, but she was the one who was with us all the time at the house. And, you know, she took us to doctor visits and into school and all those things. And I find myself filling in more of the roles that my mom did with us as kids. But, it's interesting because there have been studies about this, and they show that same-sex couples most often, or they're more likely to share the roles than straight couples are. And that's not to say one might be leaning more into one role than the other, but equally sharing housework or changing diapers or, you know, just in general what these roles are, they're shared. And I think that's kind of nice. My husband changes diapers when he gets a chance, although most of the time it does fall on me.
Lucky you.
I know, right? We do share. We share the responsibilities.
Well, I think the point you're making about the research showing that in same-sex couples, and I assume that's in gay couples and lesbian couples, that there is more of that blurring of the traditional gender roles and sharing of the responsibility. I think that really points to something that's worth saying, which is that in addition to the challenges that same-sex couples face in parenting, there are also strengths, right, of same-sex parents.
Yes, I think so, yes.
Well, you are listening to About Health. I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest is Eric Rosswood, author of The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads. And given that it's Pride Month and Father's Day was just yesterday, we're talking about gay fatherhood and same-sex parents in general. Because this is a pre-recorded show, unfortunately, we aren't able to take calls today. So, Eric Rosswood, let's get at some of the specific challenges that same-sex parents face. And I thought we could start with a really basic one, what to call the parents. I was talking with a young gay couple I know who recently adopted a girl, and they beforehand had these long conversations with each other about what titles to assume. Do they call themselves dad and dad, daddy and dad, daddy and poppy? In your book, you write that this also has to do a lot with culture, of course. So can you take a couple of minutes to just talk about this decision of what to call the dads or the moms and maybe give some options?
Sure. And I think a lot of this depends on the situation as well and the people who are making the decisions for themselves. It may have to do with if whether or not you are bringing a child into your family as a newborn or if you are bringing someone in through foster care, and maybe it's an older kid. Sometimes I've heard experiences where the parents say, we let the kids decide what they want to call us if they adopted through foster care and older children. Sometimes the parents are very specific on what they want to be called. I know for us, I'm dad or daddy, and my husband is pop. And for us, we wanted to have two distinct names so that we all knew, everyone in our family knew who was being spoken to or asked questions and things like that. I also know a couple of people who both of them are called daddy, both parents. And I asked if that was confusing and they said no. They always know who is being spoken to based on how the kids are asking questions and tones and, you know, body language and looking and things like that. So they're never confused, which I thought was kind of interesting. But yeah, I honestly think it's up to the parents. And like what you were saying, cultures might have something to do with it too. Some people may want a specific name, meaning parent or father, based on a specific language or a culture, and others may not. So it's a lot of different options and possibilities.
There's also the question of what to call the child, of course. There's always the issue of first names. But with same-sex couples, and I suppose an increasing number of straight couples as well, there's the question of the last name. I'd imagine that this can cause some tension in couples. Am I right about that?
I don't know if it's tension, but it's definitely something that's talked about. And I think now that marriage equality has been around for a while, I don't know if this is a conversation that is as common as it used to be, but I know that sometimes the conversation is out there of whether if both parents had different names, you know, which name does a child take? Does it take both names? Do you hyphenate? Sometimes with open adoption, a parent doesn't get to choose the name. Sometimes the birth parents will choose the name first, and that's the name that goes on the birth certificate. And so the adoptive parents can choose whether or not to keep that name, whether or not they want to change the name later, whether or not they may want to put one of the birth parents' names in as a middle name to honor birth parents. I mean, there's all kinds of different conversations around naming.
And if I'm not mistaken, you combined you and your husband's name, right? Ross and Wood?
Yeah, so we didn't hyphenate. We just combined both of them together. So I was Ross and my husband was Wood.
You're lucky. They fit together really well.
Very lucky, aren't we?
Of course, I think any names can fit together really well if you love the person enough. Okay. So we're starting to talk about different options regarding, say, adoption. So let's get into that a little bit. I want to talk about actually, you know, being a parent, which is most of what your book is about. But I wonder if we could take a little time to talk about where the child comes from. The two big options for gay men, of course, are adoption and surrogacy. For lesbian couples, there are other options as well, including assisted or artificial insemination and partner IVF, for instance. But because we're zooming in today on gay dads, in particular because of Father's Day, I wonder if you could take a few minutes to just talk about adoption and surrogacy as two options. How do these, you know, in a nutshell, generally work? And how do couples decide between them?
Sure. They're very different. And I think the choice between which path to choose is definitely a personal choice. For some people, having a biological connection is something that's very important to them. And I know that that is sometimes the reason that some people go with surrogacy. Some people may not have a specific tie to, you know, passing on genes. That may not be a huge criteria factor for them.
Sure.
So adoption may be another path. So sometimes it's very personal. Sometimes it can also be a cost factor. Surrogacy is much more expensive than open adoption. And sometimes there's, you know, a need to give back to a community. Maybe they want to help somebody who doesn't have a family, who may be an older child, or maybe one of the adults who is having children, maybe they were adopted and they want to adopt as well to help another kid that's in a similar situation to what they're in. So it's definitely a personal choice. My first book, Journey to Same-Sex Parenthood, goes through a ton of different experiences that different parents chose for their path and the reasons why they did it and the ups and downs, the things that went well, the things that didn't go well, the things they wish they knew beforehand. A lot more detail is covered in there. But I definitely think it's a personal choice.
Now, you've used the term open adoption a few times to describe your own children. Can you talk about open adoption and how is that maybe similar to or different than the quote-unquote adoption that maybe most people stereotypically know about?
Open adoption is where the biological parents, the birth parents, have some sort of interaction with the adoptive parent. So there's less mystery about it, and there's a lot of good reasons why open adoption is helpful to everyone involved. With closed adoption, where, you know, you don't know the birth parents, there can be a lot of questions that come up from everyone's side. So even for the adoptive parents, it's great to have information about the birth parents because you can have medical history and you can know those kinds of things that may come up medically with your child, such as if there's a history of cancer in the family, things like that. You kind of know that and you can prepare for your child's physical health and mental health. The child benefits from open adoption from knowing things like there's no mystery, like maybe my birth parents are prince or princess of this other country and I'm going to go live with them and be royalty, you know, because like when you don't know, you kind of, yeah, right. When you don't know, you create those kind of scenarios in your head of what is this? Where do I come from? What is this like on the other side? And all that mystery is gone for open adoption. Well, not all of it in all situations, but a lot of it is gone. There's not that wondering. And for the birth parents, for open adoption is great too, because back in the day when it was closed adoption, you know, women often, you know, had to place a child for adoption and then not know what happened to the child ever. And they may, you know, start wondering years down the road, you know, whatever happened, is the child still alive? Are they dead? Are they with a family that's, you know, taking care of them? Did I make a wrong decision? And so those kinds of things could haunt them as well. And I think studies have shown overall that open adoption tends to have benefits all around.
Yeah. And I'm not really sure about the numbers, but my sense from the people that I know who have adopted children is the vast majority of them have been open adoptions. Is that that's definitely the trend, right?
That's definitely the trend, yeah. More adoptions now are open adoption.
So I want to acknowledge that all these options that we're talking about, adoption and surrogacy and the others that I mentioned as well are incredibly difficult journeys for many people. I've had many friends, as I mentioned, adopt kids as well as go the route of surrogacy, and they take enormous effort and planning, sometimes years. I've seen friends experience everything from anxiety and nervousness and disappointment to love and joy and elation, the whole gamut. But in addition to all this, there's also the financial strain that I at least want to talk about a little bit. According to a recent article that I read in U.S. News, for instance, adoption through an agency in this country can cost between $20,000 and $45,000. And options like egg donation, surrogacy, IVF can be much more than that, as you've already mentioned. This seems like this really creates a divide along lines of privilege, right? Gay couples who don't have that kind of money often find it much harder to have kids. I know this isn't a problem that you have any magical solutions for. I wish you or I did. But any general thoughts or tips for couples who really want to have kids and are struggling against this financial burden?
There's definitely a lot of challenges financially. One thing that I think is important to realize is that, you know, there is a big cost at the beginning, but there's also a cost of taking care of a child as well. Mm-hmm. So there's going to be things like diapers and clothing and formula and, you know, doctor's visits and things like that to kind of take into consideration that, you know, just because you've taken on these costs of adoption or surrogacy doesn't mean it ends there.
Sure. Yeah, no, it's really expensive.
It is, yes. And then, like what you were saying with surrogacy, there are all kinds of expenses that you don't really think about. And there's also the legal expenses on top of everything for both adoption and surrogacy. There's agency fees there for surrogacy. There's the egg donor fees. There's fees every time they try to fertilize the egg as well and see if, or place the egg as well and see if it'll take. And just because you place the egg doesn't mean that, you know, it's going to take. So you never know where the fees are really going to stop. They could keep going. Mm-hmm. It's just something to take in mind or take into consideration that in the planning process, if you're talking to an adoption agency or a surrogacy agency, that it's important to really sit down and talk with the agency about all the fees that are there, but also what kind of fees may pop up that are not in the initial, you know, fee schedule as well.
Wow. There's just so many challenges here. It's amazing to me, as someone who doesn't have kids, that anyone manages to do it. It's also worth adding that it's still often hard for gay couples to adopt. In fact, on June 17th, just a few days before this show will air, the U.S. Supreme Court dealt a bit of a blow to same-sex adoption. If I'm understanding the ruling correctly, they found that a Catholic agency in Philadelphia had the right not to adopt kids into LGBTQ homes. And I'm a little confused about why they found this, but I've been reading, however, that this was a fairly narrow ruling, thank heavens. So it really only addresses that particular situation. It doesn't necessarily have implications for other agencies. At least that's the way I'm understanding it. But in my mind, this just underscores the continued resistance that same-sex parents face. I wonder if you'd like to say anything about that.
Well, like you said, the ruling just came out today, so I haven't had a chance to really look into it. And also, I'm not a lawyer, but I will say that it is an example of, you know, I mean, this lawsuit was just ruled today, or this case was just ruled today, so that tells you that these situations still exist. There's a patchwork of laws across the country, not just with parenting, but LGBTQ equality in general. And I think that it's really just underscores that we need to pass the Equality Act.
Yeah. Well, I'm David B. Feldman, and my guest today on About Health is Eric Rosswood, author of The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads. And in celebration of both Pride Month and Father's Day, we're talking about gay fatherhood and same-sex parents in general. Because this is a pre-recorded interview, unfortunately, we can't take calls today. So, Eric Rosswood, I'd like to move forward a little bit now into talking about, well, once the child actually arrives. Again, I hope it's not too personal, but I wonder if you could take a moment to think back to your own experience of your first child. Through the mists of time, could you take a couple minutes to talk about some of the things that maybe stood out or surprised you or challenged you about being a parent in maybe the first few years that maybe you weren't quite prepared for?
One would definitely be all the questions that were asked, like what we had talked about a little bit earlier, the interactions with strangers. One of the things that I would add to that is I was kind of surprised by how many times forms that we would have to fill out, whether it's at a doctor's office or at school, would say mother and father and not parent or guardian or anything like that, which is interesting because I don't think that this just impacts same-sex parents. I think overall it impacts people who have guardians that are not, you know, their mother and father. It could be a grandparent. It could be another guardian. It could be in foster care.
Not to mention parents who might be gender non-binary as well.
Exactly. So to me, I was very surprised with the mother-father comments, and I would often, I'm often listed as a mother on certain forms. I think also with genders, like our son was in first grade, and something I thought was very weird was they still had mother-father dances and activities for his school. They wanted a father-daughter dance and a mother-son activity. It wasn't a dance. It was like a play date kind of thing, which I thought was really weird because I'm not only like, what do you do with a parent that doesn't have, or what do you do with a kid that doesn't have a parent of a specific gender going towards that school activity, but what do you do with the kids that want to do activities that the other group is doing, you know? Like, what if a daughter doesn't want to do the dance? Maybe she wants to do the activity. And I remember talking to one of my friends who also had a kid in our son's class, and she was going through a divorce at the time, and she was in an abusive relationship, and she was like, well, my daughter obviously isn't going to bring her father to this dance, and how does she have that conversation and explain it to the other kids in the class? So, I mean, those kind of gender-specific activities, I think, are really weird. I never realized, and I have a section in the book about finding LGBTQ-friendly schools, but schools do a lot of things that are gender-based, even without even knowing it. Like, sometimes the teachers will make the children line up in lines, and they'll segregate, and they'll say, you know, boys line up in this line, girls line up in that line. And it's like in all these tiny details that we don't realize they're everywhere. So I think that was a big surprise for me.
And you're talking about schooling, and that's something that I wanted to ask you about. And indeed, I read that section of your book about how to find LGBTQ-friendly schools with great interest. Any tips for listeners who might be at that stage with their kids, whether they're straight parents or gay parents, and are looking for a school that is LGBTQ friendly, how do they go about finding out what they need to know to make a good decision if they're lucky enough to have some choices?
Yeah, sure. So I think a lot of it has to do with the age of the child as well and what kind of school they're going to. Is it going to be more of an elementary, middle, high school? Because different types of education are happening in those different schools. Like, for example, younger kids, when they're in a preschool or first grade or kindergarten, they're going to be doing activities like drawing their families. And some of the questions you can ask are, you know, are children going to be drawing their families? Are their pictures going to be put up on the wall for everyone to see? How does a teacher handle questions about different kinds of families when kids start asking, like, why does this family not have a mom and a dad? Why is it two dads or two moms? So kind of the situations for younger kids are going to be situations like that. As you get older, the kids are possibly going to have gay-straight alliances at their schools, and they may have courses like on biology. They're learning about where babies come from. And so I think asking how those conversations are done, maybe adoption can be talked about in those situations. How is gender talked about in those situations? Because in with the trans community and the gender nonconforming, they're going to be a little bit different in that as well. It's not, you know, men have this organ and women have this organ and that's how they reproduce. I mean, those kinds of conversations that are going to be different. So in regards to the education and how those are handled is definitely one point to talk about. There's also the conversation about, you know, how does the school handle bullying? How do they define bullying? How diverse is the school in regards to, you know, students that are different races, different genders, different religions, different economic backgrounds? And if you want to know a little bit about the diversity of the school, you should also look at the diversity of the staff. Sometimes the staff is put on websites, so you can look into that as well. If you tour the school, you can see what kind of books are in the library, if there are any LGBTQ-friendly books.
Good tip.
You can, just roaming around the halls, you can see if there are any kind of posters that are up in the halls that talk about, you know, being a safe place for all. Does the school celebrate holidays that are LGBTQ-specific, like October being LGBTQ History Month, maybe Harvey Milk Day, the Day of Silence, all kinds of things. There's a lot that we can do.
Yeah, these are really good tips. And it, you know, no school is going to ever be perfect, but I think it's so key to make sure that whatever school the kids are in is a school that is at least open and willing to work with parents about these issues when they come up. And it reminds me, about a year ago, I interviewed a psychologist named Sharon Rostosky about thriving as an LGBTQ couple. And we got a little bit into parenting. And I remember she talked about a challenge that one of her clients or research participants, I forget which one it was facing. She had adopted a wonderful little girl with her wife. And when the girl was in kindergarten, the teacher had all the kids make Mother's Day cards. And when the child asked if she could make two cards, one for each of the mothers, she was told no. That would be unfair to the rest of the kids who only get to make one card. although, I mean, you know, the rest of the kids don't have two moms. And I know with gay dads, the issue can come up in the reverse. You know, what do you do on Mother's Day when the school is having everyone make Mother's Day cards except for your child? You know, I know it's a big question, but I'd imagine these things come up all the time in schools. Any general thoughts for how parents can navigate these issues, both with their kids, but also address them with the schools?
Yes, and I find it so frustrating as well, because it's not something that's just specific to gay dads or to moms as well, but there are also other kids that don't live in a traditional mother-father household. Some kids have parents who are divorced, and maybe both of their parents have remarried. And so it's very common for kids that have straight parents to also have two moms or two dads.
Sure,
they just
good point.
May not be together. But one of the things that I found that has been helpful for me and with the other parents that I've spoken to is, for kids that are at the age where they're still doing kind of Mother's Day, one thing that you'll find interesting is Mother's Day is always in the school year, but Father's Day sometimes is not, depending on when your school ends. So they're like, fathers are not always celebrated in the school year, and kids are not always doing activities for fathers. So that's an interesting thing to think about as well. But I've found that it's very helpful to get ahead of the situation, to have conversations with the teachers ahead of time, at least a month in advance of Mother's Day happening, and, you know, talk to the teacher, and the teacher should already know that your child has two gay dads or two parents of the same sex, and you can just bring it up, like, how are you going to work with this situation in the classroom? What are you doing for Mother's Day? Are the kids creating presents or cards, or what kind of activities are you doing? And then how are you going to work it through with your family specifically? For us, I was talking about how we have a very open relationship with the birth parents for both of our kids. And so for Mother's Day, they do things for their birth moms. I know some other parents, they have their children do things for grandparents or aunts and uncles, or just a role model that they have that's female that they could do something with the card. So I think it depends. Every family is very different on how they want to celebrate the holiday. Some may not celebrate at all. Some celebrate, you know, they'll have gay dads and they'll both celebrate for Mother's Day and Father's Day for themselves.
Sure.
So it just depends on how the family wants to do it. But I think that conversation is really important to have with the teacher, because also just because the teacher may not have had same-sex parents in their class before, or they may have had it one time, and so they may just be applying what they know from the other situation to your situation, which isn't always the case because we're so diverse within our own community.
Yeah. I think it's important to keep in mind what you're saying, that, you know, the teachers may be, and probably are, trying to do their best, but they may not know. And so, you know, giving the benefit of the doubt, I mean, obviously that doesn't mean, it doesn't give license for teachers to do things that are hurtful to children or to parents, but you know, going in and exploring that. And have you found that teachers are generally open to that kind of conversation?
I have. For our situation, it's always been a great experience. One of the challenges that I've heard from other parents, though, is that each teacher is different.
Sure.
So as your child is getting older and increasing in grade, there's no consistency across the board at the school normally. So each teacher is, you know, able to do and celebrate however they see fit. So your child might be told to do one thing in kindergarten, and then first grade do something completely different, in second grade completely different. So I know someone who they told their child that they had to do a card for their grandmother, and another time they were told to do somebody different, like an aunt or uncle, and another time with someone different. And the kid came up to the parents and was like, why do I have to keep doing something different every single time?
Yeah.
So having those conversations ahead of time every single year, I think, is very helpful.
It seems like what you're saying is a big part of how to handle situations like these is to have good communication. Good communication with the school, with the teachers, to try to get ahead of it. But it also sounds like you're saying good communication with your children. And in your book, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads, you write a lot about talking to kids about these kinds of issues. And in particular, you address some important topics that often arise in families with two dads or two moms. And I wanted to get your thoughts about at least one or two of them. And the first one is questions that kids have about how the family was created. What kinds of questions do kids ask about this?
You know, I think the interesting thing is my son started asking questions about where babies come from when he was in preschool. And what was happening was a lot of the other kids in his class would all of a sudden start bringing in new babies. They would have a baby brother or a baby sister because of the age gap. So when they're in preschool, they're about 3 years old. And, you know, that's oftentimes where if someone's going to have a next child, you know, they're going to do it a few years apart. So new babies was definitely like an interesting topic for children that age. So those questions of where do babies come from come up a lot. And I found a book to be very interesting called What Makes a Baby? And I'm sorry, I can't think of the author right now, but it's a picture book that explains where babies come from in a non-gender specific way. And I thought was very, very helpful. And it doesn't shy away from different topics. It's very specific. So the language that they use is very specific. I'm not sure what I'm allowed to say on your show, but they call organs by their organs. And they say some people have this organ and some people have that organ. And they don't say, you know, females have this organ and males have that organ. And it's very inclusive. And it's also done in a way where the person reading it can see themselves in the book. So, for example, when it says the baby is born, it says that there are people there waiting for you. And that's very, very nice, because no matter what situation you're in, if you did adoption or if you did surrogacy, you know, it's relatable because...
Right, there are people there waiting for you.
There are people there waiting for you, exactly. So it talks about, you know, where babies come from in that situation. I think it's great.
The other sort of angle on this question of how the family was created is sort of like, how was our family created? You know, why do I have two dads and other people have a dad and a mom and other people have two moms? And I just wanted to tell you a little story. I have a friend, and he and his husband had adopted a baby boy a few years earlier. And he said that he didn't expect that he would ever have to come out to their son. But as the child got older, he started asking questions like, you know, why do I have two dads? Why is my family like this and not like that? And my friend said he had to find a way of explaining that he and daddy were gay and a little about what that meant. How common, I imagine very common, are these kinds of conversations? And any tips for how to navigate them?
Oh, God, it's so funny, because I remember being in a grocery store with my son, and he was maybe like 3 years old, and the grocery store was really busy, and my son just turned around, and you know, they don't have any volume control when they're that age. Very loudly, he said, "Dad, what does gay mean?" And like my heart stopped, and I started thinking, okay, I prepared for this moment. I've made a commitment to always be honest with our kids and answer every kind of question. And I'm very happy for, you know, this is my time to rise up to the situation. And I had the conversation with him thinking, okay, all these people around me are also listening to how I'm going to answer this.
It's a lot of pressure.
So I was like, okay, well, you know, gay means when a boy likes a boy or a girl likes a girl, and maybe they want to marry each other. And I just remember going into this conversation about it, and, you know, he's very quiet. And I said, does that make sense? And he said, well, I thought being gay meant happy. And I was like, oh my God. But
false alarm, right?
I found that if you're always open and honest with your kids from the beginning about where they come from and who you are, I was talking about earlier about questions where people always ask, where's the mother? And how we choose to answer that question, the kids are listening. And if we're very open with everything with them from the beginning, I find that those questions come less often, or they haven't been a shock. I find that the answers to those questions can, or those questions may come up from the kids as well, more when they're not talked about openly. Hmm. So I think from the beginning, you know, talking about where you came from, how your family was built, all that from the very beginning is great. For open adoption, if you have, you can create a book, you know, of where I came from, and you can have one printed from what is it, Shutterfly, or, you know, wherever. Sure. you can create little stories like that, or you can buy some books from a bookstore that talk about different types of families, and that's a way to open up the conversation as well. So I think, you know, having those kind of books and materials available, having those conversations that come up, and just explaining it. I find that a lot of the conversations and questions actually come from people outside of our family.
You already are sort of getting into this a little bit, but in your book, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads, you have a really nice list of LGBT-friendly books for kids. And I'd imagine that there are a lot of parents listening out there right now who might appreciate some recommendations. So can you give us a couple before we end?
Sure. If you're looking for something that shows LGBTQ relationships, there's King and King, which I know has been around for a while. Red, a Crayon Story, I think is a brilliant way to explain that some people are transgender. You know, the way that you are on the outside does not always match how you are on the inside. Mm. I think that's great. Todd Parr is a wonderful author. He's got a book called The Family Book, which talks about different kinds of families. There's all kinds of stuff out there. I do have a list in the book. I can go into more details if anyone wants them.
All right. Well, I will just urge people to get a copy of your book, The Ultimate Guide for Gay Dads. It really is a great book. And I don't say that about everyone's book who appears on the show. So I really do want to encourage people, if they're curious about the topic, to get a copy of your book, because that's another one that's worthy of recommendation. Well, Eric Rosswood, thanks so much for taking the time to be with us today. If people want to find out more about you or your work, how would they go about doing that?
They can go to my website, which is ericrosswood.com. You can find me on Twitter. I'm LGBT_activist. But the website is pretty good.
All right. Well, thank you again for joining us on About Health today.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
And my thanks to all of you, our listeners. You are the reason we do this, and I sincerely hope that this hour has been helpful to you. I'm David B. Feldman. If you'd like to find out more about me, you can visit my website, davidfeldmanphd.com, all one word. If you'd like to hear this episode again or listen to any of our past episodes, you can find them on kpfa.org. Just select About Health under the Programs page. And of course, I hope you'll continue to join us right here each week as we explore important issues impacting your health. From all of us here at About Health, may you be healthy, happy, and wise. Thanks for listening.
John A. Powell.
The Electoral College was in part a racialized system. We have a system where the South is going to come into the Union. They want to make sure that they have parity with the North. They don't have as many people. So they come up with this ingenious plan. We are going to count the slaves, who everybody knows is not really people. We're going to count them for the purpose of adding to our leisure the number of people in our state. It's called the three-fifths clause. And some people get confused and they say slaves were only considered three-fifths of a person. Slaves were not considered a person at all. It was the slave master that actually was enhanced by counting the slave, not the slave. And it created relative parity between the North and South. And so the first several presidents, including Jefferson, would not have won without the three-fifths clause.
Advancing the conversation to abolish racism for over 70 years. 94.1 KPFA.
Got any thoughts about cancel culture? Chris Hedges says the liberal proponents of cancel culture have become the grand inquisitors of speech. In his new book, Cancel This Book, labor lawyer Dan Kovalik argues that cancel culture is mean-spirited, a danger to any progressive movement, that it serves only the interests of the extremely powerful. In Cancel This Book, Kovalik argues for a total end to cancel culture and a renewed focus on solidarity, on compassion and civility. Mickey Huff of Project Censored will interview Kovalik in a Zoom event Tuesday, July 13th. For the Eventbrite link, just go to the KPFA website and scroll down the front page.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.